One of the reasons why customer resist is
the core of the spend is towards maintenance, enhancements, kind of stuff.
Don't think like an architect.
I think this should be inspiring for people.
Don't think like an application architect. Stop reading about technology in clouds. A recent conversation with a stakeholder in a large mining company. She said, I need to do something different in my business, the way I do some of my supply chain for the mining business. CIO for long was saying, I want to do something around IoT and a little bit of edge computing. And we could never make a way beyond $50,000 of POC. Okay. In business, I give a damn shit to $50,000 of POC because it doesn't make it profitable. But the moment we had that business stakeholder saying, I want to do something, I'm willing to take a risk, we were able to do something different. Even the pilot itself was almost like $1 million, because what we committed to pilot in that case was a cost saving within pilot and bring Microsoft funding to it. So portion of that is you can actually create a fairly big business with buzzwords, provided you can bring in a little bit of skin in the game, either through your own investment as a firm or use the cash cow funding that public cloud providers are willing to provide. If you can build a business case which says if this project goes successful, how much money Microsoft or AWS would make the consumption, you can easily assume 20% of that they will be willing to invest. Use that 20% as part of your business case. That probably allows me to have that buzzword related business, which is as high as 40% in the portfolio. And which brings back to that, don't think like an architect, or sometimes think like a startup entrepreneur, that how you can change the business case definition and make it real by bringing in some sort of an investment. Today, people say, I want to monetize my data. And you would see a lot of customers trying to do this big data, data lake and things like that. How about as an architect, when you are doing a legacy transformation, moving it to cloud, bring whatever data you have in those legacy system into data lake. Build your new functionality for analytics, machine learning, whatever you want to do on that data lake. So I'm saying, don't think like an application architect alone. Think like an enterprise architect and say, if I'm taking my data to data lake anyway because of whatever reason for audit, compliance, and things like that, how about ensuring take some more data, maybe which was still sitting in legacy travel systems. If that data also moves to that data lake, now you have a flexibility to build whatever new functionality, especially if it is not facing the end user. So if today an airline wants to send a very personalized content and says, hey, as a loyal customer, your loyalty points was expiring, we extended it by some duration. And by the way, since you were traveling most of the time on sector A from destination A to destination B, whenever we start, we want to do a 30% discount and give you double the mileage point. So if you want to build that kind of a model, which is where user is not interfacing with the system directly, but you could do new innovation, new marketing, new way of making money out of it. So I would say think like an enterprise architect, because if you think like a database architect or application architect, it's a difficult problem to solve. And that's where I would say cloud is less of technology. For me, it's more of financial engineering. So if you really want to be a good cloud architect, I would say stop reading about technology in cloud. Start reading about cloud economics. You would, trust me, you will be more successful if you read about cloud economics. And for that matter, now there are a couple of certifications in that area too. So if you want to test some of your knowledge, you could do that too. You could do commercial models around that. But how about making it a risk and reward proposition by saying, Mr. Customer, against a baseline, if I reduce your cloud bill year on year by 30%, you pay me 60% of that 30% cost saving as my reward. And if I don't do it, don't pay me for 1 month of managed service.
We are putting skin in the game on both sides.
Yeah, that's what risk and reward is. And then if you could figure out some sort of a commercial and capital charge model, then you should be up and running with a fantastic model. And that's where I would say digital transformation for a system integration business would happen. I guess digital transformation for a system integration business is not about, do I have a mobile app to check my payslip or leave balances? For me, the digital transformation for a services company is about, how are you innovating, how you sell your own solution, and how you build your own solution? Because that's the core for you. Because one of the reasons why customer resists is your current version is good enough for me. So you are competing with your own good work by saying that the product is good enough for me. So either SaaS is a good answer, because then you are monetizing it as you're releasing new functionality. You could probably increase your premium because you are not asking customer to take care of some of the infra and upgrade challenges. But the other thing keep in mind is why customer gets into that good enough pattern is because they are worried about the change management. So if you can make the change management problem solving easier for your customer, you would see like less resistance. I've seen customers resisting by saying, though I like your new user interface, it's more responsive, it's much more stuff, whatever it is, but who's going to pay for retraining my users because you have moved your save button from here to here or you have moved your drop down from here to here, which is a huge amount of change management that needs to happen. And sometimes people think change management is only about human. See, with the new technology, we keep on saying, you know, let's implement DevOps and things like that. So bundle a little bit of aspect of DevOps, make the change management easier. Okay? We picked up that what was the mean time between the new functionality from the day they asked. Okay, so if today a customer says, I need functionality ABC, on day one, and if it took 6 weeks for us to develop that functionality and give it to customer, and then they adopted that and a change management, which would remain constant. The way we worked is, Mr. Customer, if you stay with the current version, it is today takes 6 weeks. As it is becoming legacy, the 6 week is going to probably become 7 weeks or 8 weeks, but it is not becoming five. But if you adopt my new product, which is on new technology, new platform, then I'm willing to commit that your new functionality can come to you in 3 weeks instead of 6 weeks. So as a product company, you are making the business agility aspect real for them. But that would happen provided in your new product, you have done few changes, which allows you to make that functionality faster. And then you can bring in aspect of a little bit of financial engineering with it, okay? That for your, on average, you have 20 change requests for new functionality today, which takes 6 weeks, and then a change management aspect anyway that happens, that comes to X dollars. In the new world, if that reduces to 50%, you are saving some money.
True.
And that one, that money probably is from, should be able to offset the big portion of the big change management for the version upgrade. So you could bundle. So the key message, one key takeaway that I would say is, as an architect, do that financial engineering. Package your stuff that I am saving you money from this pocket How would they help putting in the other pocket?